I remember how we thought we were going to win.
Okay, are we ready to get started? Somebody tell me that I can start? Okay. I got that sign, so I guess that means I'm supposed to start. Welcome to our Republican nomination session of our post-election conference. Let me begin by pointing out to everyone that you have very detailed bios of our most impressive panel in here. I am going to very quickly run down who they are and who they represent, starting on the left, Mary Mine, Edison Research, MJ Lee, CNN, Michael Glassner, Trump Campaign, and a good old friend of the Dole Institute, and Bob Dole, Alan Cobb, Trump Campaign, John McLaughlin, Trump Campaign, both of them are friends of the Dole Institute. Jeff Rowe, representing the Cruz campaign, who's the only person I know who predicted that Trump would win before the election, at least at the Dole Institute.
I did that too.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Very good. Jay Chabria from the Kasich, Governor Kasich's campaign. Sarah Isgur Flores from the Fiorina campaign. Old friend Todd Harris from the Rubio campaign. KU grad Luke Thompson, by the way, Mike Glassner is also a KU grad. KU grad Luke Thompson from Right to Rise, which was Governor Bush's super PAC, and Caitlin Huey-Burns from RealClearPolitics, which most of you heard me tout as one of the best online sites of political information. So please welcome our panelists to this session. Okay, we're going to begin by asking each of the campaigns to take 2 to 3 minutes to describe what they considered to be their path to a nomination. In other words, the strategy, kind of what you felt that you had to accomplish to win the nomination. And now, all of these guys are pros, but 2 to 3 minutes is not a lot of time to do this. So we're going to be moving pretty quickly, but ask you to do that. And Luke, since we're going to go in alpha order by candidate, Luke Thompson for Governor Bush will be first.
Sure. So I should preface this by saying I was in the super PAC, so the campaign picks the strategy, but and we try to help it out. Governor Bush really set the archetype of the contemporary Republican governors in swing states, and we felt that his success at not just winning election but re-election by wide margins in a highly diverse, slightly zany microcosm of the entire country positioned him well, in addition to his obvious prodigious fundraising abilities, to be a successful candidate. We were aware that there were going to be some challenges in the primary, but we felt we could overcome those based on his record of success.
Okay. Jeff Rowe with Senator Cruz's campaign.
Thanks for having me, Bill.
You bet, Jeff.
And thanks for pointing out my Nostradamus last time I was here. So I was.
You gave quite a fright to a lot of the people in Lawrence that night.
I did. There was an audible gasp when I said it. So the theory of the case for the Cruz campaign was we were worried for quite some time that we would be pigeoned as an Iowa-only campaign, and that anybody can win Iowa. It really doesn't matter. They're not going to have the legs to go any further. So we set out a strategy to just do win one of the first four states. We said this so many times that if I sound technocratic about it, it's because I've said it so many times. We were going to win one of the first four states. After the first four states, we thought the field would shrink, and then we would have a big night on March 1st where the field would shrink additionally further. And there were a series of five caucus and primary states between March 2nd and March 14th where we would place the top two. And on March 15th, it would be a two-person race. We wouldn't win that night, but we would get a victory that night. And then we would drag the campaign out head-to-head. We thought early on it was going to be with Jeb Bush. Later on, we thought it was going to be with Donald Trump. And we would go through the remainder of the calendar, and because so many votes are massed so early, we figured we were gonna have to go to a convention, and so we would have delegates all along the way. Even in states that we lost, we would still pick up heavy delegate counts. So that was our theory of the case: preserve money, stay small, make everybody leave the comforts and confines of their home and move to Houston. So we'd have a culture of non-consultants flying in and out, making big-time decisions, but actually living and eating and breathing in the campaign cave. And so that was our theory of the case, that we could hang on, build a ideological base among very conservatives, grow it into somewhat conservatives, let the moderate in the race or the establishment person in the race have the moderates, have the liberals, and fight them over somewhat conservatives, mainly on the issue of immigration, because immigration is a issue that cuts as deep with somewhat conservatives as it does very conservatives. We have an elongated fight, take it to the convention, win, pick them as our running mate, and then we'd be up here talking about how we won the campaign today.
Okay, very good. Sarah, path to the nomination for Ms. Fiorina.
Sure. So we saw this far less in the traditional lanes of conservative, moderate, evangelical, et cetera, and much more on the outsider-insider angle. A bunch of the polling to that point was showing that that was the fight that was coming. We thought that Carly had a great message on being an outsider, that the press would, for a long time, underestimate or not estimate, in some cases, this idea that someone who hadn't been in elected office could run for President of the United States, let alone become the President of the United States. And we were great with that. We would just fly under the radar. Plenty of donors were happy to see her in the race for whatever reasons, many of which were not that they wanted her to win, but they liked her being in the race. We thought we would stay in that sort of underestimation category until the debates. We knew very much what she was capable of on that debate stage. When they then had the undercard debate and the main stage debate, that sort of threw everything into a panic. And it was a disaster. But that kind of ended up working out all right. Our plan for the actual primaries was to basically be the last one not culled in each of the first four. So we didn't need to win Iowa, New Hampshire, or even Nevada, South Carolina. We just needed to be sort of the last one that didn't need to drop out and keep exceeding the expectations from the one before. Obviously, in the end, when you combined that with the debate problem, here we are.
Okay. Jay, for Governor Kasich.
Sure. When you look at the history of the Republican primary, it's usually the experienced candidate that wins. If you go back to Romney, McCain, George W. Bush was a governor, Bob Dole, experienced senator. Our feeling was our guy was the most experienced by far, and we had the best record. So we got in very late. As soon as we got in, it was in July, we went up on TV in New Hampshire right away. It was a state that played well to us, two congressional districts, a place we thought we could play very well. And we stayed up in New Hampshire for the vast majority of the fall as well. We had two strategies, and this debate problem affected a lot of us that were on that bubble of getting on the debate stage. And so we were all constantly fighting to keep staying on the debate stage, because if you didn't, the oxygen of money would go away. So we were always working on that too, making sure that we were in the top 10. And there was this also this whole thing that all of us knew about, what the criteria for the debates were going to be. So we were all, there was this like this inside jockeying going on about, trying to figure out with the refs what the debate rules are going to be. But the longer term strategy was to win New Hampshire. Before we saw the Trump phenomenon, or before any of us did, we thought we were well positioned to win New Hampshire. And when we won New Hampshire, then it would set us up, and the field would shrink, and we would be the one standing. That was our path to victory. It changed a little bit later on when the field stayed a lot longer. We wanted to be the last man standing. I hate the term the establishment lane. I felt it was more the experienced lane. But that was really the goal there, to be the last man standing against Donald Trump there.
Okay. Todd Harris, like me, is a refugee from the 2008 Fred Thompson presidential campaign. It's great to catch up with Todd, to have him back representing Senator Rubio.
Thank you all for having me. So for us, if you think about the Republican Party in a series of coalitions, you've got your traditional economic conservatives, your national security conservatives, and your social conservatives. We felt like Marco was the one candidate who had the ability to appeal to all three of those elements, maybe not be the first choice of any one of them, but be the strong second choice of significant pluralities in each. We also felt that we had the best chance of anyone in the race of uniting, because of his appeal to each of those groups, we felt like we had the best chance of uniting the party after the nomination and going on to to defeat Hillary Clinton. So for us, we very much took the long view of the race. We didn't feel like it was important for us to win Iowa or certainly New Hampshire, but we had to stay in the hunt because, and you'll probably hear, you've already heard it a few times and you'll probably hear it a whole lot more, we kept waiting for everyone else to drop out. Because we figured as soon as we had a clean shot at ultimately, we thought it would be Trump that that we could win, but that never ended up happening.
Okay. I'm going to date you, Mike, at this point, but Mike and I have known each other for 30 years, and that's really amazing.
That's great.
And he looks a lot younger than I do because he is a lot younger, but Mike worked for the Trump campaign. Describe the Trump pathway to the nomination, Mike.
Thank you, Bill. So I don't think it's a surprise to anyone. The Trump strategy, as dictated to us by the candidate, was win everything every day. The biggest and the best win possible ever. So that was what our directive was. I think that what, you know, much like Sarah referenced, I think that it became apparent to us that there was a major desire for change, you know, radical change in the government. Mr. Trump obviously was, you know, he ran as, he's obviously an outsider businessman and never run for office before, although he'd been engaged, as he said himself, he'd been engaged in politics his entire career as a real estate developer, right, which is political, particularly in New York City, and then later globally. And then the other thing I think that's significant is this concept of, you know, there were lanes that different candidates were in. And I think it became apparent to us quite early that that didn't really apply to him, that he could veer to this lane, that lane, across all lanes. And it didn't really seem to have a major impact on his base. I think the other very significant factor that I know John McLaughlin can attest to is that we discovered early on that there was a very strong core base of Trump supporters in the Republican primary and caucus voters, around, you know, 30%, 35%, and it didn't matter what he said or did, those people were not peeling off. So I think that that sort of mass of voters made it very hard for anyone, any of the other candidates, to get much traction in light of the fact that those people weren't moving anywhere. I think another thing three other major factors we discovered, which were all sort of based on, I think, the celebrity that he had earned, you know, being in the public eye over decades as a, you know, as a TV celebrity and as a very well-known person, particularly in the media capital, New York, was his ability to command free media. And he, you know, it was all Trump all the time. He would channel, it's all Trump. And so, or very early on, he demonstrated this ability to dominate the earned media, which means we didn't have any paid media, didn't need to. So that was a very significant factor. And, you know, in the cable, the way that media is now transmitted, people in Iowa, New Hampshire, South Carolina, and Nevada all saw all Trump all day. So it wasn't really necessary to advertise in local markets because he was on the TV all day, every day. So that was a major factor. And then the third thing, which was really Mr. Trump's, you know, a very powerful media tactic that he developed, I think, and exploited better than anyone had ever done, was the use of Twitter as his primary communications platform. We had no communications team beyond, you know, a couple of people that supported some of the media, dealing with some of our friends in the media. But he dictated his messaging on his Twitter account all the time. And that would make instantaneous news and would control the narrative of the campaign. So much of our path that we saw was his ability to dominate the media and all these platforms all the time. And I think it made it much more difficult for any of the other candidates to get much traction. So, and then I think that one of the major turning points was, you know, these four early states. Obviously, Senator Cruz won Iowa, but after we won New Hampshire, South Carolina, and Nevada, I think that historically speaking, it was almost unstoppable, you know, for a candidate that wins three out of the four early primaries. And then we also felt we'd be very strong going into the Super Tuesday states in the South, we'd always drawn these tremendous crowds. And again, that's one last thing I'll mention in this short period we have, but it was our ability to raise these crowds was unprecedented, right? So our first event was in New Hampshire at the state rep's house, and it was the first and last house party we ever did because 500 people showed up and destroyed this guy's property. And we soon discovered that it was no longer possible to do private events at private homes. We had to rent, you know, first ballrooms and then convention centers and then arenas and then football stadiums to sort of contain the crowds that he could generate, even in the primary. So these Trump rallies became dominant in the media as well, continuing this pattern, and you know, persist until this day. There's one right now going on in Des Moines, Iowa, where there's going to be several thousand people showing up to hear the president-elect speak. So that the Trump rallies themselves created the tremendous momentum that became overwhelming in these states, and that's how we campaign in every single state, which had never been done before in a primary. So,
okay, very good. Thank you, Mike. I want to get everybody to jump in on this one, but in no certain order. As the race began, who in your mind was the favorite to win the nomination? And secondly, and I know what the Trump folks will say, but how seriously did you take Donald Trump at the outset? Somebody jump in and get it started. Who was the front runner? How seriously did you take Trump at the beginning?
I'll jump on that since everybody wanted us to spend $20 million on him. We figured out in the late summer of 2015, Neil Newhouse, also a Kansas City guy, was the first person, I think, in our operation to say, hey, this is very real. We were already experiencing some procedural frustrations trying to do the kind of normal pushing of opposition research to reporters and journalists and simply being told, no, we're not that interested. That included material on Trump. It was just all Trump all the time. I think he benefited on the oppo research side from having a presumption among journalists that it was baked in already to his personality, that people understood that about him, and so negative stories that we thought might have been salient weren't getting picked up. Additionally, there was a much bigger demand on the part of the media that we, you know, have all of our I's dotted and T's crossed on stories about other candidates because it was simply crowding out the conversation about the candidates. So we realized in the summer what was going on and had an intense internal debate about whether or not to attack Trump and elevate him so it was a two-man fight between Bush or Trump, or to borrow the lanes metaphor that other people have used, try to clear our lane of, basically the three people sitting to my left, and own that and then make it a two-man fight going into the convention. As the super PAC, we took our strategic cues from the campaign, and so we wound up focusing on the lane strategy. We took a lot of guff for that, but that was sort of the way we were going. But we were by no means deluded into thinking that he was unserious, at least by the summer.
Okay. Others? Caitlin, go ahead.
Oh. Well, just an anecdotal story I like to tell. The day that Donald Trump announced his candidacy, I was in New Hampshire covering Jeb Bush, who was giving his first kind of official campaign event. And I was with a lot of members of the media there, too. So that kind of shows how we were thinking about this race. I think we were also thinking about it in terms of still sticking to really everything that we knew. So obviously, Jeb Bush had all the money, and you know all the story. So I think the biggest question or the biggest focus we had was on Iowa and whether, to Mike's point, you know, translating these incredible crowd sizes into actual votes. I think that was the biggest question that we were facing. And so I think when he came in second in a place like Iowa, I thought that was pretty startling. And then New Hampshire from there. And I'm not going to be dishonest and say that we all knew he was going to win the whole thing. I certainly didn't. But I think that kind of crystallized for me kind of how we were thinking about this race.
If I could just add, just from the media's perspective, there's no question that I think at first a lot of us just didn't even think that that moment would come when Donald Trump actually announces. This is a public story that's out there, so I can repeat it, but at CNN, you know, the head of our network, Jeff Zucker, had given a mandate to producers, folks that worked at CNN, to not cover Trump until he actually makes the announcement, because he, I think, felt quite certain that that day might never come. And I think a lot of reporters felt that way. And I think that iconic sort of moment where he came down the escalators, and you know, we all know what happened afterwards. But I was taking some time earlier to go back and look at some of my stories from 2015. I was sort of confused about what had happened when. There was so much that had happened in so many candidates. And just looking at some of the headlines, it was in July of last year that the businesses involved with Trump had this freak out when, you know, because of his comments about Mexicans that were coming, you know, through the border. So like Macy's cut ties with Trump. There was a flood of other businesses that said, well, this is not acceptable. In July, I apparently wrote a story about Trump not following the usual rules of politics and sort of building up relationships with important Republican power brokers. And at the time, it was, well, how can this be? How can he expect to, you know, win the nomination when he's not even looking for that kind of important support? July 21st, Republicans were flabbergasted at the comments that he made about Senator John McCain. I remember exactly where I was standing when I saw on my phone that news item come across that he had said that about the senator, and felt so certain, well, this can't, you know, he can't continue on having said this, and so many people were angry, and, you know, all of those things, I guess, in the end, didn't matter enough for him to not get the nomination.
You know, that moment, the John McCain comment, I think a lot of us thought that was going to be the end of the Trump campaign. So I'll say right now, I didn't take it seriously at the beginning. I think he was like 18 or 20 in the polls at that point. I just thought he was going to crater. I thought it was over, and it just kept going. So there was probably the comment, this, not that one, but this next comment or the comment after that, when we started to say this is real, and he could win New Hampshire, he could win Iowa.
Jay, who do you think was the front runner at the start?
Well, I think Jeb was the front runner in the beginning because of the money. But we also didn't think that he was electable in a general. That's from our perspective. And we always thought that Marco Rubio was a formidable candidate, too. And I'll say this, too. Scott Walker had the makings of a very good campaign, too. Successful governor, ability to raise money, had a great speech, that one great speech that he made. So that was the person we were looking at, too.
Okay, I want to get everybody, so let's keep rolling here.
From the Rubio perspective, I remember sitting in a meeting with a bunch of our data people. It was some point in the late summer, and they were walking me through, from a data analytics standpoint, how they saw what the numbers were saying to them, and basically where they. Their conclusion was, and what they felt like what we needed to build our strategy around, was this idea that the race was ultimately going to come down to us, Senator Cruz, and Donald Trump. And and the thinking there was that we would be able to, that we would inherit the establishment vote, but also appeal, as I was saying before, to enough evangelicals, to enough conservatives, to be viable, while Cruz and Trump battled it out over whether it was immigration hardliners or for the outsider mantle. I remember thinking that the big hole in the theory of our data people. They were saying, as long as Donald Trump doesn't drop out, we will ultimately beat both of those other guys in terms of delegates over the long haul, because they'll be splitting it. And I said, well, there's no way that Trump's going to last that long, especially if he's not, as Michael was saying before, I just had the view that if he wasn't winning, that he wouldn't be enjoying it, that he wasn't going to stay in for this sustained period of time if he wasn't winning, if he wasn't doing great in the polls. And I said, go come up with something else, because this this idea that we can only win if Trump is in for the long haul, that's not a winner for us.
So we always sort of saw the race as Carson, Trump, and us in a nice little clump that we kind of wanted to stay close to and part of as the outsider crew, and then everyone else, we hoped that the three of us would kind of smother along the way, and you know, knock them slowly off that debate podium. I'm sure we will do a lot of complaining about the media over the course of our time here, but let me start. As I said, when we got in the race in May, but all those months before doing events, reporters wouldn't come to our events because they said she can't possibly win, she's never been elected before. And then once Trump got in, instead of not covering it because he hadn't been elected before, that would just be the headline. Can he win even though he hasn't been elected before? And then the wall-to-wall coverage because of that. That being said, that ended up benefiting us at least in some part with the comments that got us into that CNN debate. So it wasn't all bad for us. But we'd get the news cycle, 24 hours later he takes it back. We'd fight, we'd get it back, he gets it back. Carson would get it, he gets it back. And so we didn't have that presumption from the media that we were either winners or entertaining. And Trump had one of those, and these guys at various points had the other one.
Okay, other perspectives.
I also think that the 2012 Republican nomination contest sort of loomed large here. As we saw in 2012, there were a number of Republican candidates, and we kept seeing obscure candidates rise and then flame out, rise and then flame out. And so there were stories, well, at this point in the race in 2012, Rick Perry was the candidate and look what happened to him. And even though Trump was in the lead for months and kept saying, well, it's not gonna hold. And it held. But it just, I think 2012 played into that mindset that this couldn't possibly hold. It looks like 2012, one of these establishment candidates is going to emerge and we just don't know who it is. But in 2012, we all knew who it was. And in this case, we didn't, and that did not happen.
But so funny on that, imagine if Trump had had Jeb Bush's name with 4 months of leading in the polls. They would have said it was over. And instead it was like, no, he's going to flame out any second now. I don't think it was just 2012. I think it was Trump not getting that presumption that this was real as well.
Right.
Mike?
Yes.
who did you feel was the favorite at the beginning? And obviously you took Trump seriously because you signed up early with
him. Right. I think for the same reasons a lot of people did, I would say it was Jeb Bush because the money was so overwhelming, particularly early on in 2015. That he had all this $100 million, 130 whatever it was in the bank, that it seemed on the face of it, based on my previous experience, that mattered a lot. And we also didn't understand completely this idea about Trump's seemingly bottomless or endless ability to generate free media, right? So if you didn't know that was going to happen, the money looked like a lot, or looked overwhelming and that's something you couldn't overcome. So I would think, again, this campaign, I learned a lot of things. I've been on several previous campaigns. One of the hardest things for me to overcome, which I still haven't completely, is to realize that everything I had learned previously and much of my experience was no longer applicable. just like that concept of the money, right? In any campaign in the history, somebody in the lead up to the primaries, whoever had the most money was considered the front runner, and that's who was going to win probably. And that's what I thought here too. But until we learned about this, ability to dominate on all media platforms all the time, then the money didn't matter anymore.
I think it's also important for people to understand. I don't think unless you've lived through it, that you can fully appreciate when Michael says dominate. Like it's not just that it was wall-to-wall Trump coverage. We found it, and I don't just mean we, Rubio, I'm going to speak collectively for all the losers here. It was impossible for us to get any sort of message penetration with something that we wanted to talk about if we were going to be on fill in the blank show. virtually the entire interview would be us getting asked questions about Trump. And so when it wasn't Trump himself on the air, it was one of us talking
about
Trump.
Or the empty podium.
Yeah, or the empty podium.
I would say one thing from the data perspective. We, at first in the summer, we laid out, tried to get an idea in the first four states of where people were voting. And so we started to do all the analytics based on if you were going to support somebody or not, who are you going to vote for. Because therefore, in a normal campaign, then you would start going after to see who you were second choice, whose voters, if they went down, you would be the beneficiary. So we did that for a while, and it really wasn't working because it was such a big field and people would just not make up their minds. So we changed it to a consider score. Who would you consider voting for? And that made a bigger number, but at least we could see when people dropped. So our consider score overlap was completely overlapped with Huckabee. It was overlapped with Perry. It was overlapped to a degree, a little bit less so, but to agree with Marco. It was an overlap with Jindal. And so we go through these different slides in the conference room. This is right after the state fair. I'd come back from the state fair on Saturday, the Iowa State Fair, and the butter cow. You don't really need to go. It's not that big a deal.
I'm going to tell Iowa you said
yeah,
that.
Yeah, right? The fried Twinkies, on the other hand, are legit. So, so on the consider score, if you would take a look at, we would put the slides in and say, here's Mike Huckabee. When he goes down, we're going to get 78% of his consider score. No, that's great. We'd all kind of clap. We didn't clap. But, and so then they put up Trump's slide, and it was, here's Trump's score. And if he goes down, they don't go to anybody. They're not going to consider anybody else. Now, of course, they would have, but they wouldn't. This is in August. He didn't have the 30s. He was like at 18 or 19 or somewhere in there. But they literally said they wouldn't go to anybody else. That's how locked in they were. And so as the campaign developed, when we started to attack each other, we had both grown, but there was no risk. He would lose his leaners in Iowa. He would lose for sure in South Carolina when we all went to thermonuclear on each other. He lost a lot. I mean, we gained that week. Marco gained a few points. We actually came up, although we were getting hit by both. And he would lose his leaners, but his core would never consider moving off of him for another candidate. So that was troubling very early on. And I think from the beginning, we thought when we announced, we were one of the first campaigns ever to skip the exploratory phase. We knew all these people were going to run. We knew we could get to some of the Libertarian folks before Rand, and we needed to get in before him. I think Marco was announcing like April 13th or somewhere in there. Everybody was supposed to wait till after Easter. You don't want to announce at the end of a reporting period because you need to show big money. And so we announced very early on. We tried to do it with a narrative type of announcement that would add some meat to it just besides an announcement. And so we always thought that Bush was going to be the problem. And then I did not believe that Walker was fundamentally instituted to carry a campaign for as long as they were, with as big as they were early. And then after Labor Day, we knew it was going to be Trump the whole way.
Okay. Alan, John, one of you.
I started early February 2015. Clearly, Bush was the front runner for the reasons stated. However, I thought he was a weak front runner. The immigration stance was likely to hurt him in the primary. He was very adamantly supportive of Common Core, which does not go over very well with Republican grassroots. And then I saw him give a speech to the NRA, and I don't remember when it was. It was in the spring. And there was not a lot of oomph there. And I thought, this guy, I'm not sure he wants to run. And that's the voters get that. They sense it and they see it. I think that's, I'd like to take credit for the term of low energy Jeb, but I can't. But he was low energy at that NRA speech. And I think that spelled trouble for him. I thought it was serious that we could win probably in July when we withstood several of the potential downfalls that everybody here on the table and others thought, surely this will do him in. But I will say, I think sometimes folks lack some perspective. I saw the read about the comment about Senator McCain on my phone, get up, turn the TV on. I watched the actual clip. It wasn't near that bad. And I think that's how it came across. It came across as maybe a joke that didn't land. But I think folks wanted to make it something that would finally do them in. Also, the announcement When you watch the actual announcement at Trump Tower, it's not as bad as how it's reported. And finally, the first debate, where he got into the debate, the hard questions from Megyn Kelly. And frankly, the first question out of the box from Megyn Kelly, he answered it in the only way a successful answer could be, by mentioning Rosie O'Donnell. And it was perfect, it was funny. And then you know, if he can withstand all this, this is not going to be a clear path, but it certainly was not going to be as bumpy as everybody thought.
I just want to, you know, I have a lot of friends on this panel. There's a lot of people I've worked with and worked against, and Bill, I've certainly worked with Bill, and you got some of the brightest political Republican minds on this panel right here today. Fantastic, successful people. But Trump outnumbers us all. 5 years ago, I met with this guy when Mr. Trump called, and Dick Morrison recommended me. He was thinking of running for president. And we spent a month writing a plan to run for president. He was ready to run against Barack Obama. And he understood, and I was attracted to him because he thought Barack Obama was taking the country down a path that was wrong, and it wasn't succeeding. And there were people then, Corey Lewandowski was going to run New Hampshire. Did the plan, I was recommended Corey, I recommended Jason Miller, he was gonna be the manager. All those people were gonna move in. The press didn't take us seriously. They're like, oh, Trump's done this before. But what the difference was, he really disagreed with Barack Obama. And while everybody's here listening about tactics, what Mr. Trump knew, sometimes I call him Donald, but most of you worked for calling Mr. Trump at the time, they'd be like, what he knew was that the president was unpopular. And his policies were unpopular. And he was going to run, and I always believe successful campaigns are built on strategies out of big, big numbers. And we had a historic field of quality candidates on the Republican side, because inside the Republican Party, Barack Obama had a 90% unfavorable. And that's who Trump was running against. And that's where the change message came from. I remember at one point he's like talking about the Make America Great Again. And he's like, like my slogan. I'm like, I gave him a Reagan button, and it said, "Let's make America great again." He's like, "See, they had it wrong. It was let's in front." But the guy's a PR genius, and he understood that he could get these votes by running against Obama. And when you think about it, look at the field. We had all these conventional candidates, and the people that popped up, Carly Fiorina, she used to attack Hillary Clinton every day, and you had Dr. Carson. How did he get to be famous? He attacked the president at a prayer breakfast. I mean, Donald Trump was attacked by the president at a correspondence breakfast. The president would attack him. And in fact, you know, Cruz, he was the guy who came in second because he wanted to shut down Obama's government. The Republican side was a revolt against Barack Obama and the direction he was taking the country in. And Donald Trump won because he was the guy who was most anti-Obama throughout the whole thing in terms of policies and ideas. And he knew how to, like Mike said, he knew how to get attention and command media attention. But he knew what his message was. And even going back to 2011 when he was thinking of running, you know, the president would make fun of him, but he forced him to put out his birth certificate. I mean, those voters, those core voters, they respected that because, and it translated into numbers. We quantified it different times during the year. I didn't really go to work for him until after the Wisconsin primary. I started advising him and go to work for him then. But we knew each other, and he would like reach out and at different times. And he was really running his own campaign. He was his own manager, his own strategist. When you think about it, here's a public relations genius who became a billionaire based on that genius. And so he was running this political campaign, and when he wanted to talk to you, he'd talk to you, and he'd reach out to you, and he'd want to have information. And ultimately, he decided not to run in 2011. And he told me like NBC had offered him millions more for episodes than that. And I was telling him, like Todd will tell you, when Arnold ran, when we were working on Arnold's race, the minute he ran, they took him off the air. And you probably had the same thing with Fred Thompson, right? And he's thinking, I'm telling him, if you announce in 2011, you're off the air. And come this time, he was ready to do it, and he was ready to run. But he understood that message part, that he was running to change America. And the first time we asked it, we asked it in September on our own. This is my own firm. We were doing a monthly, poll about that we would put out and publicize, and it was often printed in National Review. But we started asking a question in September of 2015. Do you want to continue the policies of Barack Obama or change and move in a different direction? And the first time we asked, it was like 57-34, they want to change. And it never really moved. And ultimately, as Mike said, that became Trump's message, that he was gonna, and the Republican cells were 90% change. And he was gonna command that message and do everything he could to make sure that was why he was gonna win. And ultimately, throughout the general campaign, it was in every poll that the campaign asked, even though I was one of five pollsters. Every one of those polls, we made sure it was in there. And he understood that from the beginning, because he didn't do much polling in the primary, because Corey called me up in January, and he says, Trump's going to run this time, January 2015. And he says, do you want to do the polling? And I said, I said, the only poll, if he takes a poll now, he'll be behind. And the only polls he likes are the ones he's ahead in. And he'll fire me. So I said, I had to pass on it at the time, because I was busy working for Prime Minister Netanyahu, and I was going back to Israel. And I said, I'm not coming back. I can't help you launch and make sure we had to win that campaign. So I was busy over in Israel, but I couldn't do both and do it well. So I passed at that time. But he understood that when he went in there, that he was running to change what Barack Obama had done and move the country in a different direction, because that's what the majority of Americans wanted. And his numbers, when you all were looking at his numbers, he was moving up among Republicans that were most unfavorable to President Obama. And that's how he got his trajectory. And ultimately, that's where he was building that core, that he was able to withstand whatever was the press would throw at him or whatever was going on at the time. So, but it was message. And John, he understood it.
Go ahead.
Well, I just to emphasize John's point, but from the other side of the equation, one of the challenges and opportunities that we had in the Rubio campaign was Marco's rhetorical style and his rhetorical abilities, and we really viewed it in the outset as one of our key assets, this sort of hopeful conservatism and his incredible life story and the story of his family. And I remember telling reporters in the fall that ultimately we are still the party of Reagan, and we are ultimately still a hopeful, optimistic party. But I was seeing clear evidence that the candidates that were doing the best were those that were best able to channel the anger that voters were feeling. And certainly Donald Trump was fantastic at that. He was a maestro at that. But I also thought that Senator Cruz, there was a line, Jeff, I can't remember, he used it a lot in speeches in the debate. I think it was, you know, we're going to bomb the hell out of ISIS, or it was, but it was just the way that he said it was so good, and it summed up so much about the way that voters were feeling about ISIS, and that's a gear that Marco doesn't have. You know, he could bring you to the mountaintop and maybe even bring a tear to your eye, but he does not have that gear to get you really, really worked up and pissed off.
Okay, Jay, you get the last word on this subject, and I'm gonna move along.
So John's right, he is a maestro, he is a PR expert, but the size of the field no doubt played into that. While the rest of us were playing whack-a-mole, the size of that flame kept growing on the other side, and that 18-20% that Jeff refers to that were locked in, that started inching up and growing, and that was pretty hard too as we kept going down the primary path. So I think, yes, he channeled something. He channeled this angry, this anger that's out there in the country that still exists. But the size of the field really helped that grow.
Okay. I want to talk a little bit about the debates. I mean, the problem obviously for the campaigns, but even for people covering and trying to follow the debates, was about the size. What kind of strategic issues did that create for you in the campaigns? Or if you're a journalist or an exit pollster, you know, what were your thoughts about just the sheer size of the field in terms of the debates?
Can I just address that from our perspective? I think we thought it was a good thing because there were so many candidates on the stage that it sort of dispersed the attacks on the front runner, which by the time, you know, the first debate in Cleveland, he was leading in the polls, excuse me, which gave another advantage, which I believe was very significant then and continued to be throughout the 13, there were 14 debates, we did 13 of them, was, you know, his position on the stage was always in the middle or to the right or left, but always in the middle of the stage, which was sort of a dominant or domineering, you know, position to have. So the size, the sheer size of the field, I think, was an advantage to us because it distracted the attention, you know, across all the other candidates. As was mentioned before, several of the other candidates were in attack mode with each other, which I think, you know, ended up, in my view, diminishing one or both of them in the end, and it was less impactful on us. So the fact that there were so many people up there saying so many different things sort of dispersed the ability to concentrate, excuse me, their fire on the front runner, which is typically what debates are for.
Okay, other thoughts?
So we, being the super PAC, you're not involved with the debates, even though they're some of the most consequential moments. So you have to sort of work around the margins of that. They're also one of the times where you sit there and watch like a hawk or like you're reading tea leaves to try to figure out what the heck does the campaign want us to do, because we have the big wallet, but we don't want to do something that will box our candidate into fighting fight he's not comfortable fighting. So we watched the debates with intense interest, and we did a lot of clever things around the debates to try to, you know, get ideas into the heads of the attendees. But I will personally say that I think national name check polling in the summer of an odd numbered year is a stupid way to set criteria for debate attendance. Even though it worked actually really well for us, it's purely a name check, and there were two names on those stages that everybody'd heard of. One was Bush, the other was Trump. Put us next to each other, they're both about the same height. So it was visually, I think, quite striking. And Trump used that as an opportunity to just beat us like a pinata. And we were a very, very good foil for him. I think that a big part of his strength was a coherent strategic message that was not just against the president, although that was a big part of it, was running against Obama, but also running against politics itself, right? He was running against this idea of grubby, petty politicians, call it the establishment, call it whatever you want to. But in many ways, the same reason Sanders was successful running against politics, I think Trump did that, and we became the just physical embodiment of that, standing next to him, having him basically just say horrible things about us like we did 9/11. I mean, it's not actually what he said, but he insinuated that we lied about that former President Bush lied about the Iraq War. And I think that, for me, was the most striking moment when I realized, okay, you know, we are being used as a prop to support Trump. He's doing it extremely effectively. It's very smart. Are we going to hit back or not? And we stuck to a different strategy of trying to clear our lane, which I understand, and that's what, you know, you've got to pick, and there's no right way to do it at the time. But yeah, I think, would you guys agree that we were a great foil for you?
Yeah, and I think another thing that was done very effectively, to turn back to this issue of funding and the money, mm-hmm. was that, you know, that became a central point, it always was, of Mr. Trump's strategy was his self-fund, you know, he was paying for himself, for self-funding, largely, almost completely, but we were able to turn the money as a weapon against mm-hmm. Bush also, right? He was the puppet of his donors, and he was just doing what they were telling him to do, and so forth and so on. So he flipped what had been historically and in every campaign known to man an advantage, this overwhelming cash advantage, to a weapon to beat him over the head with it very effectively.
So I want to say one thing. When you do campaigns, you're trained to not look at public polling because it's terrible usually. Mm-hmm. But when you're on the bubble of this criteria, trying to see if you're going to get on the stage or where you're going to be, you're on pins and needles every week trying to see, are you going to make it? And then, okay, well, CNN said the criteria is this, or Fox News said it's this, so we have to try to do our projections, and it's awful, because that's not the way we're trained to do campaigns. And then you get on the stage, and we happen to be on the end of the stage almost every time, I think. And it's well, you get in the CNN debate at the Reagan Library, we got two questions. The debate was like 17 hours long. We got two questions. So you have this frustration, like, how are we going to get through? And then so then you try to break in, and then the media says, oh, he's sounding angry. So then they start grading on style points. And so the debates are stupid.
I would also say the bar was set very low for Donald Trump. I think the bar was set low for him during the primary debates, and then the bar was set low for him again during the general election. You know, we were writing stories as we entered into the debate season about Donald Trump never having done this before. He had never stood on a debate stage. There were so many other more experienced candidates who had either done this before or knew the policy better. And then I think there were a lot of, you know, preconceived notions about how one is supposed to act on the debate stage. No, you can't make a joke about Rosie O'Donnell on the debate stage. Actually, who made up that rule? You apparently can, because he did that. So I think in a lot of ways, obviously, journalists and reporters were sort of expecting, I think, Trump to make certain mistakes or not perform as well. And then there was obviously sort of the theatrics of the various debates that sort of took over the coverage. And I think with Trump literally standing center stage and, you know, taking the spotlight in so many ways, I mean, I can understand that many of his opponents would have been frustrated at feeling like, you know, the very smart policy answers they were giving were not getting enough attention, that, you know, sometimes a debate coverage would be sort of reduced to this one, you know, hot exchange between Donald Trump and Marco Rubio, or, you know, Donald Trump and Jeb Bush going at each other. But yeah, I think that the debates were challenging in some ways for journalists to cover, because we had never covered those kinds of debates before.
To be fair, there were no hot exchanges between Trump and Marco Rubio. He was in witness protection during the debates.
I'm not sure it's fair to call them debates. The primary wasn't debates. It was talking points at a camera where we were standing next to each other. And to the point you made earlier about how the media, for each of the other candidates, it just turned into respond to Donald Trump. You know, at the CNN debate that Carly was in, if you remember, the very first question at that debate was, Carly, Trump said this about you, respond. Mm-hmm. That was the opening question of the second presidential debate for the primary. I mean, that's journalistic malpractice. That's not you guys having trouble covering the race. And I think Jake Tapper's a very talented journalist, but that was the entertainment aspect. And on a point that
so,
you said.
So that was a very good moment for Carly, and I don't think she regretted having had a very good moment when she was, you know, at the time struggling to.
Which should make my point all the more powerful, that it benefited us, and I still think it was bad.
Sarah earlier had teased that we were probably going to beat up on the media quite a bit, and she teed it off, and I guess I'll pick up the ball. Some of you may have read coverage from the Harvard panel last week that several of us went to and got into a bit of an exchange with the president of CNN. I should state at the outset that this is not specific to CNN. This is I have this issue with all of the media, and specifically all of the cable channels. But the cold hard reality is that the news media covered Trump because he was great for ratings. And everyone knows it.
Look at all the nodding heads.
Everybody knows that. You won't hear network executives owning up to it, but we all know that that's true. And as a Republican and as a capitalist, when I think of it through that lens, I say, okay, I get it, that sucked for us, but I get it. But we shouldn't pretend that it was for, you know, news value or for reasons other than what it was.
I just want to make a point. Sorry, what Todd was saying about that the ratings, and so this is a point I made at the Harvard conference also, was that particularly in the primaries, it turned into this cycle that had never existed before. Trump would go on, they'd get higher ratings, they would make more money, his message would be disseminated for free by them, and then they would have him on again for the same reason. So they would make more money and you get more messaging. So it was this circular circular process that had never existed before, and it was a winner for him and it was a winner for them. So they just kept doing it. And it was highly effective. It was impossible to break through for others.
As you guys pointed out, right, Twitter only reached 20% of the electorate, as it turns out. It's even fewer if you discount, if you add in non-voters, about 13% of Americans. So how is the other 80% hearing about the tweets?
Right.
Well, if I, I'm mostly a print reporter, but I think that what was really striking to me about, in terms of coverage, is that the coverage of Donald Trump was extremely negative. I mean, the coverage was surrounded.
No, it was not.
No, it was not. No, every study has shown
64%.
That it was
not. No, I'm saying positive. About what he was doing was perceived or was the phenomenon is that it wasn't, right? So negative coverage saying, Donald Trump said this. Can you believe he said this about McCain? That would, for any other candidate, the coverage of that, I think, would drive them out of the race. I mean, Walker had a couple moments that, you know, he was covered for something he said, and I, you know, kind of fizzled in some ways. So I think that there was this phenomenon aspect of it that you can't deny. I mean, someone who keeps continuing to say things that would, for any other candidate, drive them out of politics. I mean, that is a story. I mean, it's hard to not cover that. If I could just speak for that part of it.
Well, 64% of what the New York Times said about Trump during the primary was positive. 91% in the general was negative. And the TV.
They went up to 76% if you did TV.
Yeah, the studies are pretty clear that it was positive in the primary and overall negative in the general. But I would say, to the extent that there's anybody that's going to listen to this in 4 years and try and craft how to not do it, the debates, I will tell you, when we benefited from the debates were big and fractured, and it became more of a find your moment, plan for your moment, deliver your moment, than it did an actual reaction of a debate. And we practiced and studied what our opponents would say and try to bait them to. But at the very first debate, we announced we had a week to raise money. We raised $4 million. Then in the second quarter, we raised, I think, right at $11 million. So we had $15 million total raised, and we had about $8 million on hand. And I'll never forget, we were sitting in a conference room after a donor retreat in Colorado, and we were looking at the polls to see if we were going to make the first debate stage. What Ted Cruz ended up to be, Ted Cruz wasn't at the beginning. We were asterisks in Iowa. We were negligible. We were with everybody else in the primary, in the national polls, and so we were going to miss it that day. If they cut off that day, and this was about a month and a half out, if they cut it off that day, we're going to miss it. And I remember Ted saying, "We can't miss the stage, or we don't have an argument for victory." And I thought that kind of settled in on me, and I'm like, "Oh no, we could like miss the first one, but make the second one." And he was pretty insistent. He said, this is going to dry people up. If you think we're going to raise $10 million, next we want to raise $10 million each quarter. If you think we're going to raise $10 million after not being on a debate stage, you're fooling yourself. So we actually planned and laid out, and Rick Perry actually did it. A week later, he went on TV, National Fox, and spent $3 million. We almost spent seven of our $8 million on a national advertising buy, which is crazy. But you can't do anything else. And the only thing that saved us was he had announced this book. We did a book tour, which got us some news. We decided to move it up and do it over a holiday week, so at least we'd be the only people. You know, Trump wasn't talking that day, evidently, or something. But that week leading into the 4th of July, we could get a little attention and at least be part of the news. And then the New York Times left us off the bestseller list. And then we got 4 days of news. We went from 3.5% to 7%, and we made it, you know, one in from the end on the debate stage. But that's how paralyzing it is. I don't know what the solution is. I know doing fewer debates is not smart, in my opinion. I think you can break them up. I mean, there's a thousand ways. I don't want to solve it for everybody. But I can tell you it had an overwhelming presence, because the number one indicator of who's going to win the presidential campaign is the media share. It's the number one forever. For all these pictures on the wall, whoever got the most media wins every presidential election. The second factor is money. And the third factor is endorsements. And this year, the endorsements didn't matter. So the money is driven by how much attention you get. So the media share that you get as a percentage of each day, 15-minute blocks, we measure them all. You can't get enough just on one cable show. You have, and that's why Trump was so overwhelming. Tonight, Megyn Kelly is the number one watched Republican eyeballed show. And she is, as a total, she has 19,578 viewers in the Kansas City DMA, which is like 3 million people. She has 19,000. In a 15-minute segment, she's actually 615th ranked in overall programming. Now, the Chiefs are on tonight, so that screws everything up, so she'll drop a bunch. But that's why it's just not the cable, actually, although the cable's the most pronounced because it's the most obtuse. It's the overwhelming nature of the Channel 4 or Channel 5, or if you're in Kansas City, the Channel 9 coverage, which is spawned off the cable. And that's why it became such an overwhelming force, and something that is, it's a reason why it's a predictive analysis, is because it is the thing that predicts everything, is how much attention you get, bad or good.
I would throw two things in there on the numbers, too, that we found, because obviously we're spending a lot of money on paid media, and we're trying to figure out how things are going. The local stations drew on the national cable to set the priority list of what they would cover. We found that they were much less likely to be as hostile or negative towards Trump in the primary, that the local stations were much more sort of looking like reportage, just kind of relaying this was what was discussed. The second thing is that, and you may hear cable executives, they seem to have dropped this canard recently, that, oh, well, they were just following the polls. This is empirical nonsense. It is, in fact, objectively, observably, and provably false. CNN moved first. All of cable moved about 2.5 to 3 weeks before Trump's polling started to move. I'm not saying that there was some elaborate plan to do this. I don't think there was. And I do understand it's a business. Ratings are important. But do not allow cable to say, we were just doing our journalistic due diligence and following the story. They created the story. That's fine. On the other hand, I'm told that CNN expects to see about a $100 million windfall above their projections as a result, they think, of Trump. This was in the public. That's not a lot of money for one of the largest cable stations, actually, if you think about it and you break it up over the cycle of 10 months, which is essentially what the 2016 election is. It's $10 million a month. For a cable news station, that's not a huge amount of money. So even the cynical, we're doing this for reasons of capitalism argument, doesn't have a whole lot of oomph behind it.
One of my friends who's a producer said to me, Trump's like crack. We know we shouldn't do it, but we can't get enough of it. And direct quote. That's when I knew we were done.
Okay, I'm running out of time, so I want to move this along, and I have dutifully scratched out my note about did the media provide an unfair advantage to the Trump campaign, which has been, I think, thoroughly, I think that's been thoroughly answered today, at least in the perceptions of the other campaigns. Let me talk a little bit about the early primaries. Jeff, Senator Cruz won Iowa, Mike and team, Trump wins New Hampshire. What was your perception from the other campaigns, what was your perception of the race at that point going into Super Tuesday?
Well, Super Tuesday, when we lost South Carolina by 1,500 votes. We lost Nevada. Well, I say lost, out of second place. And I'm glad that somebody acknowledged we won Iowa, because if you listen to Trump or Rubio, they won. Carson, I think, won.
Stole first place.
True.
Ben Carson had it stolen from him, evidently. Was there a Carson person here, right? Or the scam packs don't get on these stages.
I'm speaking for Carson.
Yeah, exactly. For usual, that would be the truth. So I think after we had New Hampshire and we didn't do well, we competed actively. We stayed in the whole week. I wasn't excited about staying in the whole week, but it was good to get third there. After that, we wanted to survive the field, and it was really getting hot for us because the whole field was really attacking us, because then we became the problem to them getting Trump alone. And so we then went into March 1st and thought, we have to get rid of Rubio. We cannot, if Rubio's there, one of us is not going to make it. And so Super Tuesday for us, we spent $10 million on Super Tuesday. I think it was about $12 million total. And we spent about $6 million against Trump trying to keep his delegate count down, even in states where we couldn't win. And we spent, and we knew we had to win Texas or we were going to drop out of the race. True, Ted said that on a donor call, which routinely seemed to leak. I don't know that we would have dropped if we won Texas, but we certainly didn't have a narrative to go forward. And he said we were going to drop, so if he said we were going to drop, we would have dropped out. But we also knew that we needed to win one other state. So we picked Arkansas and Oklahoma and Alaska. And Ted called the Alaska shot. I wouldn't have spent any money up there. But we spent $100,000 in Alaska positive and won by like a point and a half. He still claims he won that state, which he did. I mean, he won every state, actually. But we spent a lot of time in Oklahoma, a lot of stops, a lot of visits. And then we spent $7 million against Rubio in Georgia, Tennessee, and Virginia to keep him, try and keep him from winning in Virginia, to try and keep him below 20% on the delegate threshold in Georgia. And if I had to do it again, the only other thing I would have done is spent money against him in Minnesota. Because if we beat him in Minnesota, he wouldn't have won a single state. And maybe we could have got him to drop out before March 15th, although probably not. But that was our goal. We had to win one state. We won in Oklahoma by 2 or 3 points. And that's where we spent the other $1.5 million, which is a lot for Oklahoma.
Okay. Anybody from the Trump campaign want to comment on status of the race after those first two contests?
The one thing I didn't really understand fully about Mr. Trump's political base was the importance of Florida in that. And I came to understand it very quickly after we spent some time there. But in fact, you know, he and his family have been there for decades. He's a major employer in the state. He owns several very significant properties there. And what I saw happening, you know, in the lead up to the primary was all the hallmarks of a candidate's home state. We would be overwhelmed backstage by friends and relatives who wanted a picture. We always generated our largest crowds there, you know, regardless of where he went. We stayed at his Mar-a-Lago there for 68 nights, which was a good thing.
Yeah. I'll do that again. Try the Holiday Inn in Des Moines.
Yes, better. It was good. But it came obvious to me that, obviously, New York, he's associated with New York, but in fact, Florida was his political base. And knowing that gave us a lot of confidence, particularly when there were two other, you know, the major candidates were relying on Florida as their base. And so the margin of our victory there was very significant for us.
I might just jump in regarding Super Tuesday. I don't think anything happened that we were not surprised. Michael, I don't know if you remember, you and I on the phone trying to guess every single state, and every state's delegate counts are a little different. You have to get 20% here by congressional district. We expected to lose Texas. Thought we had a shot in Oklahoma. We didn't play in Alaska, so whatever happened there was fine. Maybe we should have, since it was so close. And so I don't think there's anything surprising. I think we expected a good night, and we got a good night on Super Tuesday, mm-hmm. which set up for the remainder of the least next 2 weeks in March. You had four contests on that Saturday, March 5th, which we split with Cruz, and then Florida, I agree with Michael, always looked fairly good for us.
Other thoughts at that point in the race?
Okay.
Go ahead,
John. I was going to say, I really didn't get back involved with him until after Wisconsin. I'd seen him the day before because I was doing Hannity radio at Milwaukee, because Sean said I had a face for radio, so I've been doing a lot of radio for him. But and Mike will tell you, it's like he saw him the day before and he said, so we're going to win Wisconsin? I said, no, you're going to lose. He attacked Scott Walker in his home state, and he's beat unions before. And it's like he's held off tens of millions of dollars. It's not going to work here. So he called me up the day after Wisconsin and said, can you meet? And we met, and he was worried about New York because he had lost then. And the interesting part is we had plenty of, you know, because we polled all over the country. I was like, you're going to win New York. And Mike, we actually wrote a survey for him. He was ready to take it. Because I put off a trip to Florida myself to meet with him, and we spent hours going over the survey. And then two surveys came out where it was over 50%, and he's like, now we don't need it. But actually, there were parts of New York where if he felt, it's the tricky thing, where if you fall under 50% in a congressional district, you don't get all the delegates. And so he had to get over 50% in most of the districts to max out New York so he could win the rest of the Northeast, where he was doing well in Pennsylvania, et cetera. And he was like, what about Manhattan? I'm like, nah, you're not going to win Manhattan. Kasich will win Manhattan. So why? I said, they're your neighbors. But don't drive by Trump Tower now. The traffic is but what I said to him when we met that day, I said, your problem's not New York. Your problem's not the Northeast. Because Cruz had hurt himself in New York when he did the New York values thing in Iowa. Because I had guys like Pete King who weren't originally with Trump, but all of a sudden it's like it's Cruz and Trump, we're with Trump. And because that New York values comment. And they did play that. But then I was like, it's not New York, it's not the Northeast, it's going to be Indiana. Because we were doing polling for the Indiana State Senate majority, and virtually every district I had in a primary, Cruz was winning. And I was like, you have to start now to win Indiana, because if you lose Indiana, you'll have an open convention. And you don't want an open convention. If you win Indiana, you'll be able to seal the race. And that's what he did. And Mike had him, they had him out there, and Paul Manafort had him up with TV ads in Indiana, and he started just a little earlier to make that the place. Ironically, that's where Governor Pence was with Senator Cruz, and but ironically, Indiana was the way he sealed the nomination, so.
Okay. I'm curious, how much of a problem was it for everyone other than Mr. Trump that he was averaging he was getting 40% of the primary vote, according to the numbers we crunched, 40% of the primary vote in every primary up to the point where he was a presumptive nominee. I mean, I remember, Jeff, you being here back in October and speaking to the fact that until you could get it to be a one-on-one race, it was going to be very difficult to beat him. I wonder what you think about that and what some of the other campaigns and individuals on the panel think about that.
No, he definitely built up to that. I think at 24% or maybe 22% in Iowa. But as we went along, something happened in that Northeast corridor and the New York, and that's that the Republicans became convinced that he was just going to win anyway. And so what happened to us in Indiana, we never had in a survey, which we didn't do polling in that way, but. We never had the lead in Indiana, but after New York, going into New York, we were down 4 in Pennsylvania. After New York, we were down 18 in Pennsylvania, from a Sunday to a Thursday. And what happened after New York, which I didn't think it was that remarkable of a victory to win your home state, it hadn't been for anybody else leading up to that, although Kasich did have confetti cannons.
We got it. It was a lot of confetti.
There was a lot of confetti. But it wasn't really a big deal. But then Bill O'Reilly said that he's never seen a more spectacular political moment in his life than Trump winning New York. And we're like, what? And so what happened is we didn't grow past, not a single new voter was added to us after New York. And in fact, as we started to see the consolidation behind him, our own voters at a 91% rate thought he was going to win. Our people. That's why the Clintons did what they did, which is this whole public perception campaign of they were going to win, because if you think somebody's going to win, that's a pretty good indicator of who's going to win. And so that's why they did what they did. But in the primary, what became overwhelming to us is that we just couldn't – it was a fait accompli that he could not win, or that he could not be beaten. And the 1243, and we threw everything out about delegates, and we threw everything out about – Louisiana, when we took Louisiana delegates, even though he won the state, we won the delegates, and we would try and get every single process story that this is going to convention and that we're going to win the state. We have these number of delegates in California, and it just became overwhelming, and we couldn't consolidate. We couldn't consolidate Kasich people because he stayed in the race.
We did.
We got Rubio's people too late. Because we stayed into Florida, and so by then there were so many delegates already gone. And so it was just hard for us to, you could feel it slipping away on states, and we didn't want to fight in Indiana. We rather would have fought the next week in Nebraska and West Virginia, because we were going to lose West Virginia, but we thought we'd win Nebraska. And to Ted's credit, the Monday before the Tuesday in Indiana, we had four, I won't say who they are, so I'll say we had several governors that were going to endorse in Nebraska. We were going to stop and do a press conference, and we were going to fight Nebraska and try and make Nebraska this big holy war. And he said, let's not do it. Let's see how we do in Indiana first. I don't want to put him on the record in case it doesn't go well. So, yeah, Indiana wasn't a good place for us because the Kasich voters, which were particularly inner suburban, we just couldn't get them, even though they pulled out of the state. They still got 9%. And so those states with other candidates in, when we lose, when Trump, I think, got 54% in Pennsylvania, if we lose to him like Bernie lost to her, 54-46, that's not a bad loss. But when you're giving up 10 or 12 points to a third candidate, now it's 54-35, 54-28. I mean, it was just, so we could never build it back.
I just want to make a footnote on the observation about New York. What a Bill O'Reilly, who grew up in Levittown in Long Island, what he was amazed about Trump, here's this guy who's a billionaire, lives on Fifth Avenue, but his real appeal is the outer boroughs and where he did best was Suffolk County, where like the chairman, John Laval, and Erie County, where you have Carl Palladino, where it was this working class voter that was coming out of nowhere and maybe hadn't voted in a Republican primary, but they were showing up. And it was that was the paradox that went right through Election Day, his appeal to like working class people.
I would just like to add something too about this idea of the, you know, this core 40%, whatever it was, is that I wouldn't be a responsible Trump representative if I didn't take my turn at bashing the media. So I'm going to have, he'd be disappointed if I didn't do that. But I think that this was sort of a continuation of the conversation that had happened all the way through the primaries, which was John referred to this, he wasn't serious about running. He would never announce. He would never disclose his, you know, do the financial disclosure that was required, which he did ahead of schedule and very well. He would never get any momentum. And then there was this idea about, you know, the ceiling. Like there was, it was 10%, well, he'll never get higher. Well, 20, 25. And that, you know, went up and up and up till, you know, Jeff referred to later in the primaries, it was up there. So again, I think that was sort of something that the media invented, was this idea of a ceiling that he could never exceed. And I think that lulled some of our opponents and others into a sense of complacency that this thing was real and it never was.
I would say on that point and to the point that Jeff made, I think in retrospect, the big hole in the theory, certainly that we had, and I think that a lot of others had about this idea of just waiting to get, you know, we each wanted our shot at Trump. And I remember early in the campaign, I said, you have to think of this as a pie with like 16 slices. One of those slices, it's the biggest one, but it's not a majority, but it's made of titanium. So no matter what you do, you're never going to make that one any smaller. But as candidates drop out, we can consolidate the rest of it. The hole in that theory is what Jeff was alluding to. There is a psychology of winning that, no pun intended, but it trumps everything. And what we hadn't thought through was if in order for Marco to ever even get, or any candidate, to get to that point where you had cleared the field and you could get a clean shot at Trump, in order for that scenario to have occurred, you would have to have a series of contests where Trump was winning and winning, or and almost winning and then winning. And by the time that you got there, the math might work, but the psychology has been broken.
Okay, I'm running out of time, so I want to get to two more questions very briefly, then we'll open it up to any Q&A from the audience. Luke, I don't mean to pick on you, but I got a specific question for you.
Sure.
Governor Bush was largely presumed to be the front runner at the beginning of the election.
Which we hated,
strong,
for the record.
Yeah,
we hated
the strong favorite. You got out of the box raising a lot of money. Everybody else really was perceived, at least at the time, of swimming upstream. In retrospect, what do you think happened?
Thanks for the easy question, Bill.
I'm sure you've thought about it a lot for the last several months.
Yeah, well, I liked your Super Tuesday question because I was just sitting in Malibu drinking beer and watching the waves come in and not in Iowa or anywhere else or Wisconsin. I think a few things happened, and there are lots of theories of them, and I'm going to, instead of propose the macro theory, let me put something out there that I don't think has been discussed, which is Governor Bush ran in a fundamentally different Republican Party than the first two presidents Bush had run in. And I see people nodding, you're thinking it's bad ideology, et cetera. That's not actually what I'm saying. W ran in 2004 as an incumbent president for re-election 2 years after the most dramatic piece of legislation, restructuring campaign law, had been passed and before any sort of significant updates to practice had taken place. It was also before the serious kind of fragmentation of a broadcast media environment thanks to the internet. We as a party have lived out of power during one of the most dramatic transitions in the way politics is executed through the rise of super PACs, through the weird distortions that those create between candidates and organizations supporting them, and at the same time that we've had the collapse of television and before that print as major channels for message dissemination. The Democrats are going to get a taste of this now, and they are woefully unprepared to deal with it. It is going to rock their world. But when you don't have the threat of presidential excommunication under an environment of asymmetry between outside groups and hard dollars that the candidates directly control, let's just say people with distinctive opinions have access to the public square, in some cases to a greater extent even than the candidates themselves. And you wind up, I don't want to say that you wind up with a tail wagging the dog. I am, for the record, against pretty much all forms of campaign finance restriction. I think they create perversities. But certainly a big reason why I think Governor Bush struggled was he ran a campaign familiar to anyone who'd watched his older brother's campaigns. That campaign in 2000 and 2004 was very well suited to an era of soft dollars and broadcast, not particularly well suited to a much more fragmented era in which it's much easier to bootstrap a candidacy into existence and then survive.
Okay. I'm going to start, Caitlin, with you, and I want to go through the panel. I'm going to ask you to do a yes-no answer. If you feel that that's unfair and you feel obligated to add something to it, feel free to make a quick comment. But after Trump was the presumptive Republican nominee, going into the conventions, did you believe that he would win the general election? Okay? Did you believe he would win the general election? I'm going to start with Caitlin. We're going to go right down the line.
Oh, gosh. No. I didn't originally.
Okay. Luke?
Going into Cleveland?
Going into the convention.
Yeah, I did not think we were going to win going into Cleveland.
Okay. Todd?
No.
Sarah?
Nope.
Jay?
No.
Jeff?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm on the record at that time, too.
Yes, John?
Yes, I was on the record like Jeff with a lot of articles saying we could win. And some people said to me,
wait,
oh, you
could win is different.
You said you could, yes, but you said you could
win. I believe that you would win, John.
I believe we could win. And
editorial modification, that's fine. Alan?
Yes. Yes.
No.
MJ?
No.
Mary?
I thought it was a real possibility.
Okay. Fascinating discussion. We're going to open it up to your Q&A. Somebody was supposed to bring a microphone up to the center aisle right here. Please queue up at the mic. Please ask one question. There's no way I will get to all the questions because I've got a tight schedule to run. So no need to queue up more than about three or four people. We'll stop it at that point, Barbara. And please direct your question either to an individual or to one of the campaigns. Kevin?
Ms. Main, given what we've heard this afternoon, do the terms left, right, and center still have utility in American politics?
Thank you for your question. So I think that they do, because I think that, and I think this kind of speaks more to the general election, but you know, the independents and the moderates are ultimately the ones who decided the general election. And we saw that 18% of voters in the general election disliked both candidates, and that group broke overwhelmingly for Trump, and they are the ones that decided this campaign. So I'm going to call them moderates. I don't know, you know, if they are or not, but they disliked both candidates. They broke for Trump, and so I think that that it still has relevance.
Okay, next question.
Early in the campaign, there was a coalescing and said, will you support the presumptive nominee? And there was commitments across the board. What strategy or thinking was behind not fulfilling that commitment?
You're talking about the for the people who said that they would support the nominee or the ones who said that and then did not do it?
Yes.
Jay, is that just you and me?
This question is to any Republican campaign that signed the agreement to support the nominee and then did not endorse
Trump. It was a question of conscience for my former boss. It was. At some point for him, he felt like he had to look his daughters in the eye. And there were certain things that were said and done during the campaign that he just couldn't support anymore. So it was just that simple. It was not strategic in his mind. It was not strategic. That's what I want to make sure I get across.
Ditto.
Okay. We're going to have time for actually maybe more questions than I thought, so if we want to line up more questions. If you have a question and you're physically unable to queue up, hold up your hand. Somebody will bring you an index card. We'll try to read it. Okay, next question, sir.
Ms. Flores, there are definite parallels that could be drawn between Carly as a successful business leader and a non-establishment candidate, and Donald Trump as the same thing, a non-establishment candidate and a very successful business leader. Do you believe that Donald, because of his bombacity and obnoxiousness, just because of that, do you think that Carly would have done better if he hadn't have been quite as bombastic?
I think there's a theory of the race where if Trump hadn't been in, Carly could have been the nominee. But I'm sure everyone here
would have done great.
Yeah, exactly. So we'll save that. I do have an interesting note on that, something John said earlier, which is they decided early on to run against Obama. We decided early on to run against Hillary. And we thought that as the primary went on, voters on the Republican side would see Hillary as more and more of a threat, and the numbers showed the opposite. As our primary went on, if you polled Republican primary voters and asked them, do you think Hillary Clinton will be the Democratic nominee? Increasingly, they did not think so, to the point that by the time I think Iowa came around, 60% or something did not think she would be the nominee. Huge number that for us, you know, living in our world, we were like, of course she's the nominee.
And we've all proven to be experts in politics.
Right, exactly. We know so much. We're very good at this. Forget that he's Donald Trump and we're Carly Fiorina. If you just looked at two candidates, they made a good choice.
Okay. Next question. Yes, sir. Quick.
I want to ask the Trump guys about two apparent pulled punches from an alleged renegade outsider, hard fighter. One, what I previously mentioned to the panel before about the Trump using the word rigging a lot in terms of the election, the economy. It's clear it's in the economy. But he did not go to the level of election fraud, which there is this paper here from the 2012 Republican primaries by Choquette and Johnson, Republican primary election 2012 results, amazing statistical anomalies, that shows that the outsider, Ron Paul, was hurt by apparent election fraud as precincts got bigger, and the insider establishment candidate, Romney, I think the integrity of our constitutional republic deserves a few facts. I'll get to it right here, okay. So this would, in Trump is the alleged outsider. He never brought this information to the front. That's first. The second pulled punch is around these Podesta emails. There is some very strange stuff around coded language that fits with the FBI's description of pedophile rings. My point is Jeffrey Epstein before the election started, Jeffrey Epstein was a convicted pedophile.
Sir, ask your question. You're disrupting my program. I'm going to have to ask you to leave if you don't.
Why didn't Donald Trump talk about Jeffrey Epstein, the convicted pedophile billionaire who would have brought down Hillary Clinton?
Was it because he was connected?
Oh, my God.
It's not worth answering.
We couldn't beat Trump. You think we could rig an election?
Just calm down a little bit. The question, please.
It is completed.
Do you guys want to answer or do you want to pass?
No.
Okay. Next question, please. By the way, I don't see any... By the way, I don't see any students lined up, so if you're a SAB student from KU, or if you're from one of the other universities, I've still got about 5 or 6 minutes I'm going to do, so get in line here, ask your question. Yes, sir.
Yeah, this is to the Trump campaign. A lot of us like Ben Carson, and when Trump started to compare him to a pedophile, and also when he started whining about Cruz stealing the Iowa primary, did he not realize that he was turning a lot of us off, and was that a planned strategy on your part?
I'm not sure we understood. Would you try that again?
I don't understand the question.
Well,
who is the question directed to?
At the Trump campaign.
Okay.
Well, what I was saying is that a lot of us like Ben Carson, and when Trump made that remark about when Carson had that tried to stab this guy in his autobiography, and Trump says, well, that sounds ridiculous. That's like a child molester. Or when he started whining about Cruz stealing the Iowa primary, a lot of us started getting turned off by Trump. Did he realize that, or was that a planned strategy to...
Okay, did you guys realize that you were turning people off, that Trump was turning people off?
We probably had some ideas, but I just want to mention, ultimately, not long after Ben Carson endorsed Donald Trump, so it must not have been too bad, and frankly, that was a big help to us in the rest of the primaries, and particularly some states that were very delegate-specific without having a presidential preference, so I think we must have treated Dr. Carson fairly well.
Okay, next question.
My question is also focused to the Trump gentleman. I have met both of you and know you somewhat, and I think you're both decent, classy guys. I'm
here it comes.
The wind-up.
As a Hillary supporter, which I'm sure you're not shocked by, I'm really surprised at the behavior of our president-elect during the campaign, and I'm more surprised by the fact that two people I respect a lot and I think are really decent human beings would work for this man. So could you tell me, because I know it's not anything, I know there's a reason why you worked for him, so can you tell me why?
By the way, she's only saying two, so I guess I'm left out.
She didn't know you, John. You're off the hook. Okay, so Alan, Mike.
You're deplorable.
Thank you. I don't know that there's an answer to that. I mean, this is our profession. We do this for a living. We like to win campaigns. I'm sure that there are other people, possibly in this room or not, that would say the same thing about people that work for Hillary Clinton. So I don't think it's really a legitimate question.
You know, I'm going to go back. I'm going to say one thing is, like, because I deferred in 2015 to get involved because I was busy with the prime minister. But when I got back, I spoke to other candidates and everything. I tell you, I've known Donald Trump for years. And what attracted to me was his message that he wanted change. And a lot of the election we'll talk about tomorrow was Hillary Clinton and not Hillary Clinton. And the majority of Americans in the polls never supported Hillary Clinton. She may have won the plurality of vote, but she never had the majority support in the polls. And ultimately, I got to tell you why. The reason when he called and I wanted to help him at that point, because he had proven himself that he was going to be the agent of change. He was the most anti-Obama candidate, for those of us who think that the president's taking us in the wrong direction. And two-thirds of Americans think the country's on the wrong track. That's still today. And, you know, and Hillary Clinton, people thought she was going to be his third term. So it was easy to work for Donald Trump and not let that happen again. In fact, you know, Republicans, that's where they coalesced, because as somebody already mentioned, a lot of people were unfavorable to both, but they ended up voting for Trump because they wanted this change.
So, Helen, you want to say something?
Donald Trump, every candidate in the field, every candidate I've ever worked for has flaws. We're all flawed, and I think sometimes the question indicates maybe Donald Trump's being held to a different standard in some ways, that he hasn't lived a politician's life, Hang on now. He hasn't lived a politician's life that's tried to script every single minute of his life. We've all been around those candidates from age, they think they're going to run for president at age 18, and it's not really them, they're scripting their life. I think that was refreshing to be around Donald Trump, that he wasn't scripted. And anybody who's been around Donald Trump one-on-one, he's as personable and personal, as nice as anybody as you'll meet. I was at a lot of round tables with him. He did not patronize anybody. Where candidates, that's one of many candidates' flaws, is they patronize. They let people think that they only care, that they tell them what they want to hear. He looks them in the eyes, asks good questions. He's as good one-on-one with any candidate I've been around. I was happy and proud to serve with him.
Okay, we're down to two individuals in line. We're going to get both your questions, and that's going to be the end of this session.
This one goes out to any of the campaigns. So earlier you guys talked about how Trump kind of capitalized on the pissed off American. Going to the future in other elections, do you think the Republican Party will try to use that strategy in future elections, kind of using the anger of America to their benefit in the general?
Well, I guess it depends if our country is still so pissed off. If president-elect, soon-to-be President Trump, if he delivers on even half of the things that he, or a third of the things that he talked about doing, and if you take him at his word that he wants to unite the country and bring the country together, if those things happen, or if we start making progress in that direction, I as I said before, I ultimately believe and hope that that we are not an angry nation, that we are a hopeful, optimistic nation, and things are just really screwed up right now. But if some of those things can get fixed, then I hope one day that the candidates that are the most successful are not the ones that do the best job of appealing to anger, but the ones who do the best job of inspiring.
Okay, let's take our final question.
Thank you all. This is a question for anyone who wants to answer it. I teach a political communication class here at the University of Kansas, and during the primary season, my students, regardless of who they supported, kept coming back to this idea that Donald Trump was the most authentic candidate, and authentic as a positive, he's a really authentic guy, authentic authenticity. And what I wonder is, for all of you in this extremely mediated age, where my students are getting their information from Twitter and Facebook and Snapchat, what does authenticity of a political candidate mean? And do you think it matters? Thanks.
Very good question.
I'll jump in real quick, because I think it's similar to what I just mentioned. I think it does matter. It's like a lot of things, you know when you see it. I think we can all tell when a politician's being scripted and memorized speeches, and when someone might say something that we're all thinking, but oh boy, but politicians really don't ever say those things. So I think it does matter. I think it's hard. You cannot make it up, right? That's why it's authentic. But I don't know. It's so difficult. I'm not sure it's going to be some new wave of authentic candidates. I think that's something we'll have to see at the legislative and national level.
One of the mistakes people make sometimes is, okay, we just had this election, so the next election is going to be exactly the same. They never exactly the same. The next election will be different. We'll learn lessons from this one. We'll learn how to communicate a little differently. Candidates will be different. There'll be a bunch of candidates saying drain the swamp in 4 years or 2 years, whatever it is. But so while you have to learn lessons from this campaign, campaigns are going to be different, and we have to adapt to what those are.
I will say, from a tactical standpoint, there is when voters are looking at campaign material, whether it's a campaign videos, if it is perfectly lit, if the candidate is dressed, to the dressed perfectly, if the way that they're speaking is overly slick, for a lot of voters, they will instantly discount what they're hearing, because they will feel, well, this is clearly packaged. It's probably poll tested. Which is why you see a lot of campaigns, especially for what we do online, moving to entirely stripped down formats where literally sometimes you'll just take an iPhone and say, okay, go. And, or, you know, maybe they'll be driving in the car and you shoot that. And you use vehicles like that to try to get your message out for the exact reason that you're addressing, because there is just a sense for the voter that they're getting a little peek behind the curtain, and therefore that must be more authentic than versus scripted.
But that will also change over time, right? The rolled coat sleeves and the slick video was authentic 15 years ago. This is reality TV authentic. In 10 years, we will see that as completely inauthentic. I think Donald Trump, as someone who had done a lot of reality television, was able to capture that feeling that Americans now see in their televisions at home every night. I think in 10 years it will be something else. So to your point about not overlearning lessons, if anything, don't rerun 2016 and 2020 is the lesson.
And I will quickly add, having been to dozens of Trump rallies, I mostly covered him during the primaries. I would talk to voters at most of the events I went to, and the question I most often ask, you know, to get them started is, so why are you here? Why are you attracted to Donald Trump? What do you like about him? And I think the answer that I got the most frequently from, you know, most of the people that I talked to was, he tells it like it is, he doesn't sound scripted, he just seems real. And I think that was something that stayed, you know, going into the months of the election.
I think another way to measure that too is through accessibility. I mean, I think the same way that Bernie Sanders was appealing to a lot of people was because you could actually go to his rallies. And in the beginning, you know, Clinton was having those, you know, smaller kind of more scripted events. Same with Trump in a lot of ways. I mean, I just think he was accessible, to Todd's point about, you know, doing these Instagram videos and such, and just reaching people exactly where they were and making them feel a part of it. I think the accessibility part was really a measure of that.
I might also speak to that, just to follow up on that. And his ability to use social media was highly effective. I mean, if you have Twitter, which I do, and I, you know, rely on it greatly, and if you read particularly during the primary months, if you read one of Donald Trump's tweets, you knew it was him. There was no doubting that was his voice. And that, I mean, that the ability for a political candidate to communicate directly in that way with no filters, no editing, no spin doctors, no nothing, I think, contributed to this authenticity that he was able to embrace.
Okay, anything else? Okay, just so that I go on the record, Alan Cobb's been kind enough not to share this story, but Alan called me up when he was thinking about going with the Trump campaign. I told him I had two pieces of advice. One is, doing a presidential campaign is one of the greatest experiences you'll ever have, so take advantage of it. Two, be ready to look for a new job after the Iowa caucuses. So and I appreciate he hasn't called me on that day. But anyway, join me in welcoming the panel for a great discussion. We thank you all. This has been tremendous. We will start tomorrow morning on the general election. We'll have a little bit more time to go into detail tomorrow, but we'll start tomorrow morning at 9 a.m., so we hope to see you then. Thanks for coming out.